This show would not be possible without the support of our listeners, patrons, and sponsors. If you'd like to learn more about supporting the 3-Bit Gamer Show, check us out on Patreon at patreon.com/3BG. And a huge thanks goes out to our boss-level patrons, Christopher and Patrick.
So I got my COVID shots today.
Oh, nice. Yeah, how are you feeling?
Pretty miserable, honestly.
Wait, did you say shots as in plural?
Yeah, you're supposed to get 2 shots.
Yeah, I think you're supposed to get those like 4 weeks apart, though.
Right, but I didn't want to take any chances.
Where exactly did you get these shots, JD?
The shot guy. Over behind Albertsons?
Oh, at the pharmacy. Wait, did you say behind the Albertsons?
Yeah, just like behind the back of the Albertsons. The guy's super nice, and he did it for like super cheap. He didn't even ask for my insurance.
Yeah. Hey, hold on 1 second, JD.
Hey, 911. I'm gonna need you.
Hey, JD, I'm just calling you a quick ambulance, okay?
Hey, you don't need to call an ambulance, man. Oh, wait. Yeah, no. Call the ambulance. Welcome to the 3-Bit Gamer Show. I'm JD.
This is Peterson.
And I'm okay, you guys.
He's okay now.
It got here in time.
He had to get the antidote. He's fine. Guys, don't worry about it. He's fine. This is not the first time this has happened to JD, and I don't think it'll be the last.
I got an IV drip. I'm fine now.
I'm pretty sure he was poisoned and drugged at the same time. So
the guy gave me the poison and the antidote. 2 shots.
Live from the 3-Bit Gamer Show, the news.
All right, our news this week is brought to us by Crave Cookies.
Crave!
If you guys are here in Salt Lake or anywhere here in Utah, because it's not that far of a drive, it's worth it for cookies. I mean, if you're in Nevada, you only have to drive like 5 hours to get here.
Depends on where in Nevada you are. If you're in Vegas, it's like a 6-hour drive. It's worth
still kind of worth it, though.
Just do it.
I mean, I still remember back when we were driving to Vegas for In-N-Out from Salt Lake, and didn't complain then. So you guys can drive up here for Crave Cookies. Guys, go to cravecookies.com. Check out Trent's awesome new website. They still have the Cad Bunny Crave, which I believe is Trent's favorite cookie. It's rolled oats, peanut butter, Cadbury mini eggs. Oh, they have the weirdest texture. I love it. And Ghirardelli milk chocolate chips with a white chocolate drizzle, which is how you know Trent likes the cookie, because he drizzles it in white chocolate because that's his favorite.
Yep. all his favorites get the white chocolate drizzle treatment.
Yep, exactly. He's also got the baked butter beer, which does in fact taste like a butter beer, except unlike the butter beers at Harry Potter Land, it doesn't cost $17. Mm. Oh, JD, you're exaggerating. Point, that's way too much. They would never charge that at Universal Studios.
Oh, gosh.
$17. All right, guys. So let's get into some news. Okay, so I love the Activision beat. I've also decided, moving forward, our style guide on this podcast will reflect... we're just going to call them Activision. It seems profane to call it Activision Blizzard. So let's just stick with Activision.
Let's be honest. We're like 6 months for them to just going straight to Activision at this point.
Let's just accept that Blizzard's in the grave, not try to resurrect them or necromance them at all. Let's just move on.
Well done.
Just pretend that they're dead. Activision has released a online-only PC game, which was Crash Bandicoot 4. That it was online-only, but it had no online content. So there's no justification for it other than, I guess, they're really trying to avoid piracy, which is in the clumsiest way possible. That's like... I don't know. Like having a retina scan in your car constantly connecting you to like GM in Detroit to make sure that you are in fact the person still driving your car at all times. And if you blink for too long, the car shuts down.
Don't look away from the retinal scan or it'll just throw
what a laborious
up your
process
immediately.
Dude, there's no justification for it if there's no online content, but this is called DRM, and it's weird to me. I remember when they started talking about this with the last generation of consoles, so the PlayStation 4 and the Xbox One. This was a big discussion. Online restricted content that required you to be online all the time, especially games that you got hard copies of, mm-hmm. And how kind of scummy that is. Well, it's okay. It's okay because there's folks out there, cracking groups that are dedicated to cracking the software limitations that enforce the DRM. And they released a simple patch for the game that scrubs out the online requirement. This is such an easy thing. I think you just go into the game files and just swap out one thing and you just drop this in there and it patches it out. And they did this within a day.
Immediately.
Like right away. It's so weird to me. DRM is just this. It seems like it just inconveniences and annoys legitimate paying customers. And it does nothing to prevent piracy, because guess what, guys? No one cares. They're going to figure out a way around it. Obviously, the cracking groups, that's not a crack for people that bought the game. So they have no problem pirating your game. It costs them no energy whatsoever.
Yep.
But everyone else you do kick off when their internet goes bad and they're playing Crash Bandicoot 4, which is a completely offline game.
Yeah, it's a single-player offline game.
And their internet goes down and you're just like, F you, you're out of the game. You're trying to steal it, aren't you? Fuck you! Give us more money!
We knew you were trying to steal it. We knew it the whole time.
The second your internet went out, you're done, buddy! You're on your keister, Mr. Dude, Internet comes back on. They're like, oh, welcome back, friend.
Welcome back, paying customer.
Now we can connect to your credit card once more, and we're all good.
They knew Crash Bandicoot was going to be a highly volatile title when it comes to pirating. They just knew this was going to be a big one.
That's the thing. It's like, this seems like it took no effort. This was like some guy did this on his lunch break, or maybe like while he was on the toilet in the morning. He's like, oh, let me just crack Crash Bandicoot 4 really quick.
I could see him. He's playing it and he's like, oh, he disconnects from the internet for a second. It goes off and he's like, wait, what? He's like, that's not right. Opens up whatever.
I have no idea what these guys do.
But he opens up something. He's like, click, dig, 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 dig. Okay, install, pop, pop, pop. Done. And then he just goes back to Crash Bandicoot.
And he uploads it. He uploads it to the internet. He's like, hey, everyone, if this is annoying you as much as it was me, here's this free thing I made on the toilet.
I was really annoyed when I couldn't play Crash Bandicoot. He's probably not even a professional hacker, too. It's probably just some kid.
That's just some guy.
Like, what?
This is so dumb. I can't believe we're still having the DRM discussion.
Yeah, it's
in 2021.
It's nonsense.
But I can believe it because it's Activision. Speaking of more scummy practices, which is unfortunately a lot of what's going on this week. After previously stating that this would be released as a reward in a future event, so they were going to have an event in Marvel Avengers, and it would you'd get these things, these skins, as a reward. These are the MCU costumes.
Yeah, they had like the MCU.
They've been talking about these forever, man.
Yep.
Like, so long that everyone's like, are you guys still fucking, is this still a game? Is Marvel Avengers still a game? So instead of releasing these with the event, because they're like, well, we can't release them with the event. No one's playing anymore. They can't get enough people together to do an event. They're just going to sell them for $14 a pop.
Each. $14 each.
What? Are you guys crazy? I looked today and there were 262 viewers of this game on Twitch today. Oh, total. Gosh. Total. And the number of like owners or people that own the game is like hundreds of thousands. Like, what a precipitous drop off. And yeah. So instead of like trying to, I don't know, take care of those customers at all, because they just don't care. They're like, dude, there are a couple dummies that are still, this is, dude,
no,
we go back
to this.
Can't
wait to get
this
those guys.
This is Luke on the island milking whales. He's just squeezing it out, and he's like, man, there is so much milk in these. And they're like, $14. And this whale's like, how many skins are there? Just squeeze my teats. Six times, seven times. I don't give a shit. MCU stuff is cool.
You want to play the MCU characters, right? Isn't that what you wanted all along?
This is cynical, even by like gaming industry standards. And it's Square Enix, who is not really notorious for like shitty practices. It is kind of funny. This is like their first kind of foray into this type of game economy.
It's not going well.
And they're like doing everything wrong as they fucking can. They're making mistakes that companies were making back in like 2015. This is Skyrim horse armor stuff, dude.
Oblivion,
I'm sorry. So what a mess. Marvel Avengers is just going to make sure to go out, not with a bang, but just like, I don't know, man.
Yeah, this is, it's ridiculous. Plus, the price is ridiculous. $14. $14 a pop.
I think the game is like $20 right now.
Well, that's how they justify the... Dude, I guarantee you could find it for $20 somewhere. Yeah, wait a month, you'll find it.
Shopping results here. $20, dude. Yeah. I get it on Gamefly. I get it on GameStop. This game is $20.
Dude, $20 and then just drop another $30 on two skins.
They budgeted in the MCU skins. I could be Scarlet Witch. Which, like, in a third-person game, what is cooler than a character in an all-black outfit that you can't see?
It'd be so sick.
$14. Where do I sign? here's another good one. There is a next-generation update for The Witcher 3 Wild Hunt that's going to be coming out in the second half of this year. For the people that played Cyberpunk and were like, huh, man, I wish this was The Witcher. CD Projekt Red's like, all right. You know, we tried to do a non-Witcher game. It sucked. We're cutting our losses. Have The Witcher 3 again. It's not a bad boy. It's going to look
a little bit better. It's going to just a tiny
Let's just forget bit. About this whole cyberpunk thing. Cyber what?
Who? I'm still going to play it, JD. How? I still want to play it. I just want them to do a little bit more updating. Just a little bit more.
just a couple years more. It's going to be great in 2020. Dude, Cyberpunk 2078 is going to be really good.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah, they just changed the year on it. Like, no, I don't think that's how it works. And NBA 2K is like, that's exactly how it works. You just up the number. No one even says anything.
I mean, the biggest problem you guys are going to face, which you already passed, is going from 19 to 20, because then you have to change two numbers. But then you just coast for
guys,
9 years.
You guys don't have to worry about it.
To NBA 2K19 to NBA 2K20, it was a bear. I'm telling you. But after that, 2K21, 0 to a 1, brother, it only took us like 2 weeks. It's great.
It took a team of 40 people... 2 weeks to copy and paste that. Essentially what they ended up doing.
240 people, 225 managers.
Same group. What they couldn't figure it out. What they ended up doing was just taking a snapshot of a one and just dragging it over the zero.
An image. they didn't Photoshop it because their Photoshop guy, they fired in the last round of layoffs. So they're like, can anyone do paint?
And also, they forgot to renew the license on Photoshop. It was a huge mess. He was in charge of it. So now,
and some middle manager comes in like, you guys are such idiots. You're talking about licenses for Photoshop. You don't know that paint is free.
Everyone do your work in paint now.
Everyone in EA does all their work in paint. If you can't do it in paint, it's not going to go into the EA game.
We're not paying for more licenses.
You know what the shareholders want? They don't want you to have licenses. They want money. And paint is free. Okay.
Oh, my gosh.
Peter, so why don't you do this next one about Microsoft?
Where are we?
Well, there's this one about World of Warcraft, but I feel like we can't do without Trent, so we'll do that next week.
Yeah, we'll hold that one. Okay, so Microsoft, back in 2018, they entered the defense contract business, which is kind of interesting, but they are...
Good business, killing people. It's tight.
They won a $479 million contract to do AR headsets for the military. That's cool. That's a big contract, right? Well, now they've announced that this deal, which this happens a lot with military contracts, this deal has now increased, and it could be worth up to around $22 billion over the next 10 years. That's no joke, right? That's 10 years worth of work for...
That's Boeing money.
For
that's
a bunch Boeing of people, contract, right? We're talking billions. This is that's a good contract. You're going to keep a lot of people employed with that contract, which when you're in the defense biz, that's the goal, right? And essentially all it is they've got these AR headsets, right? They want to test it with the military. The soldiers would be wearing these augmented reality headsets, which would be giving them information, right, that they didn't have to, that they could just see. Essentially, they're looking at a video game screen.
Microsoft was like, dude, you guys see Master Chief, right? You guys played Halo.
We could give you Halo. We'll build you Halo heads.
Do you want to be Halo?
Do you want your guys to be Halo?
I could just see them calling them Halo.
I could see the first headsets coming out just being the exact same Master Chief helmet. And the U.S. military is like, is this the only way we can get people to sign up for the fucking military? And it did gangbusters for our numbers. Dude, are you kidding me?
If we were like let standard you use issue, a real
yeah, helmet.
Halo helmet.
And like a gun, and they're like, people are like, I can go get a gun like at a vending machine in America. Like, I don't give a shit. Like, you're gonna give me a gun in the military? I have 5 guns. They're like, no, this gun has a little screen with numbers on it, tells you how many bullets you have. Everyone would sign up. I would sign up.
Well, all right.
Where do I shoot? Don't even tell me. I'll just start shooting. This sounds dope.
I just want to pull the trigger because I want to see that number change.
I want to see the number go down. So very cool that Microsoft is gamifying war. I see no downside to this.
No, this ever. Is fine. This is fine. We're like 2 steps away from super soldiers, which
we're so fucking
the movies and books always say that's a good idea.
Every sci-fi movie ever.
Super soldiers work.
You should make war easier and more cool. That will mean there is more war, which is very cool.
Guys, war is cool. Haven't you seen a movie?
Haven't you guys seen the Microsoft-made gaming headsets you get to wear while you're killing people in a desert?
Dude, we're also like 1 step away from Microsoft making a VR war simulator. And they'll be like, if you're good at this, you're going to be
automatically get signed up.
Mm-hmm. Dude, it's like,
you'll be good at real war.
The Last Starfighter. We're really close to The Last Starfighter happening on Earth, which is weird. With Microsoft, of all things.
Congratulations. You've beaten fake war. Would you like to try real war?
You're now enlisted. They're just going to show up with like a Dodge helicopter. They don't care if you're a 14-year-old living at home. You're in. They're going to pick you up. They're going to slap a Master Chief helmet on you and send you over to whatever country we're shooting.
Oh, man. Where do I get my hands on one of these?
It's probably going to be pretty cool. Like, to be honest, having a HUD on a helmet sounds pretty
sick.
It's
just the shame of all this is that we're such a backwards species that we're still killing each other.
Well,
these are the things we should be killing aliens with. Like, come on, let's go be genocidal on aliens instead of each other. Like, grow up as a species a little bit.
You know, it's whenever something happens like this, when like a company that's like a non defense contractor company gets a defense contract, there's always like a group of people who are like quitting their jobs over it and upset about it. There's a group at Microsoft doing the same thing. They're like, we thought this would be used for, what'd they say, architects, engineers, surgeons, and other professionals. We didn't think it'd be for weapons. Newsflash, this is America. Every good Everything tech developed is. Goes into what? The military
just funnels up
the military,
into the military.
They've got the money, and they're the guys going, wait, can we use this? If the answer is yes, they will throw a whole bunch of money at you to use it.
They're like, does it blow up? You're like, well, I mean, technically, yes. They're like, should it blow up? You're like, I mean, no.
We didn't really build it for that. Like, it doesn't matter.
Can you control the blowing up? You're like, I guess technically, they're like, we will take $100 million worth of that.
And you're
thing.
Like, oh, did you say $100 million?
Oh, it blows up all the fucking
we've
time.
We've sold
I can't even
seven,
tell you.
But yep, this is what we do now. So yeah, there's a
calculator.
There's a group of people at Microsoft that are saying, oh, they're, you know, making demands that they should cancel the military contract. Did they not hear $21 billion? There's no way Microsoft's going to cancel that because it doesn't feel good, right? They're a business. So if we can warify anything, we're going to.
We're
going to
warify, gamify, warifying stuff. It's going to be really cool. I hope maybe we can use these headsets on non-human targets. I don't know. What about all the boars in the South? All those wild boars.
We got to
so
have
fascinated by that.
We got to do something with those
if
guys.
If you guys need to kill something, go kill boars. Apparently there's so many boars and they're terrifying. You need to feel like a man, kill a
no,
boar.
JD,
it can kill you
stop.
Back.
JD, shut up. The military's going to hear you and they're going to weaponize the boars.
It's gonna be God, no. Weaponized boars.
That's how you're going to control them now. You're going to make a headset. You put on the boar. The 14-year-old can now control the boar from his basement. Just running.
Each of your joysticks is one of his tusks. And it's just a goring sim.
I don't like this.
I love
it's
this.
Just so gross.
Okay, so that's pretty cool that Microsoft's getting into the people-killing game. Congrats, guys.
Hey, join me. Join me, Microsoft. This is what I do for a living. So. This welcome to the dark
of death,
side,
John Peterson, making sure that all the bomb makers are getting their benefits on time.
Who can we get next? What company can we bring to the fold?
Okay. In other Microsoft non-war news, Microsoft. This is a opinion article that was on Kotaku that I thought was kind of an interesting point. It was opinion, but I mean, he just laid down cool, hard facts, about the title is Microsoft is supporting old games while Sony and Nintendo are leaving them behind. I think anyone would agree with this statement, especially yep. fans of Sony and Nintendo games. No one would dispute you on this. They're like, I know personally, there are 1,000,001 Nintendo games that I wish I could play. Old ones, Game Boy Advance games. Like, don't tell me you can't put a Game Boy Advance game on the Switch. That's horseshit. You could put the whole catalog on the Switch.
If you can put The Witcher 3 on the Switch, you can put any game from your past on the Switch.
So the fact that they've gated these, a lot of these classic games behind their like Nintendo Switch Online service, which is kind of
it's just the ones they release though. Like it's not you can't just go in and find any of them, right?
So, I mean, Nintendo, there is no argument to be made that Nintendo is doing a good job of managing their catalog. And when they do release games, they are really re-releasing old games or ports. They're essentially ports in the Nintendo Switch at full price, $60. You're releasing a 25-year-old game that you've just cleaned up a tad for the Switch at a $60 price tag. Are you nuts? It's like they don't want people to be interested in this stuff. It's weird. I don't know. That's weird. Same deal with PlayStation, which is very interesting considering the PlayStation used to be the leader on this. I remember how cool it was to play old PlayStation games on my PlayStation 2. I remember when I got my PlayStation 2, I played all the PS2 games that I could get my hands on. I started borrowing PlayStation 1 games from my buddies that were like over it because they're like, oh, we don't need to. And I started going crushing the old PlayStation 1 catalog because I didn't have one. Mm-hmm. And the fact that I could do that was a huge draw to the console. I think this is not something that Sony wasn't aware of, because if you remember the original PlayStation 3, the launch version of it, the one that was like $700 and just like a big, huge machine, that one has an incredible resale value if you can find a working one, because it actually has the ability to play the hard disks of PlayStation 1 and 2 games. The game, the PlayStations they released after that didn't. And there, I mean, there was blowback on that. And the fact that people are still really wanting the old PlayStation 3 that plays these games proves there's a huge desire for this. But at the same time, PlayStation's not really doing a lot. I think they're doing better than Nintendo, arguably. But in terms of like putting old games up, Microsoft is just kind of, it's like people want to give you money and Microsoft's like, cool, we'll take that.
Yeah,
that's easy.
These games exist, and yet feels part of me gets really sad because it feels like a lot of these games that I remember from my childhood are like disappearing into obscurity.
Yep.
Even if, you know, you just give me a legit online database where I can just play all these games, not a ROM where I have to download and like do all this stuff, you know, on my Raspberry Pi or whatever. Like, why isn't Nintendo just have all these?
I shouldn't have to solder my old video games to get them to work.
Dude, I don't want to do any of that. If you know me, I would rather just pay a couple bucks to play some game that I have, you know, that I've got my nostalgia goggles on for than like, some tech guy listening right now is going to be like, no, it's so easy. Let me tell you, and then they're going to give me this whole process that's not easy to me. And so, yeah, I just want to buy it. I want to pull up on my Switch a full database of like everything. NES game. Just show me all of them. Give me NES, Super Nintendo, all of them. Just pull. I want to see it. Pull it up. Just put it on there. It needs to exist.
You'd
somewhere
make money.
Like, legitimately.
It's been done. Because people have done it in their free time for free. The fact that you can go find these ROMs online.
Dude, they could just pay. Hey, we'll pay you guys $5,000. We'll pay someone $5,000 to just get this ported over
just
and
put
have
them on
it
the
good.
Switch.
Yeah, no
I don't
problem.
Understand why they don't do. I think the Nintendo moves at such a strange pace. if you look at like Pokemon, for example, the things the community's been asking them to do with Pokemon for decades, and they just don't seem to give a shit, and they just keep releasing like lazier and more phoned in games, like they're worse.
Yeah,
and it's and everyone's like, wait, what do you guys? Why? They just do it, man.
They just do what they want when they want how they want. I'd say they're very. They're not the worst, but they're not the best at like listening to the consumers, what people want, right?
They're
pretty good at it. Sometimes they're like brilliant at it, and sometimes they're just
yeah. The Switch itself is proof that they can be very brilliant. But oh man, I don't know. So I thought it was a really interesting point. I am bravo to Microsoft for making money. They do have a really good venue for this with the Game Pass, but I'm not sure that that's any different. You could make a similar argument about Switch Online and the PlayStation Store or the PlayStation Plus service. Like, PlayStation Plus should be providing this. You guys even trying to compete with Game Pass? If you wanted to, go scrape the shit out of your PS1 and PS2 and PS3 catalogs and get them to us.
There.
Get them in front of us, and then people might actually be interested in PS Plus. The things that I see in the news when they're like, oh, PlayStation Plus games this month. And I'm like, eh.
It's like two games.
Eh. And it's a monthly thing? Bitch, I want that forever.
Yeah, I want to keep it. I want it for 100
That's
years.
That's my standard. Sorry, EGS and Game Pass have screwed that up for you, but you're just phoning it in and
one
you're
month?
Not even putting your old games on there?
Like, I've got nothing else to play? No, you give it to
you
me.
Bitch!
For free.
You better give it to me
for give free. It to me for free, and I want it forever. I want the license to this, and I want it for free, and I want it right now.
I'm sorry, you're in the video game industry, and you didn't know that we're all just a bunch of entitled shitheads? Wake up!
Give me two games for 1 month? I'm not even going to think about it yet. I have, this. You make
get out of here
sick.
With those pinto beans. Fuck you. Yeah. So good luck. Microsoft Game Pass, really, they just keep crushing it. Got to fund the war crimes. All right, so MLB the Show, which I guess is the only good sports game. You know, I was thinking to myself, JD, have you ever heard people talking shit on MLB the Show? Or every time you see it mentioned, is it like a dope trailer with cool music? And everyone's like, game sick this year. Sweet. Thanks, guys. Like, that's all I feel
like
hear
it's
about
like
this.
A quiet audience or something.
Yeah. They just kind of keep to themselves. They're not trying to bilk people for money. This is so, what is it? What are they? It's like San Diego Studios or what are they called? The guys that make this?
Oh, I don't know.
It's going to drive me nuts.
You'd have to look it up.
The show.
Sony Santa Monica.
It is San Diego Studio. What the fuck?
San Diego.
I guess that I was right. That's what it's called. That's a weird thing. They used to make NBA games until like 2010, but now they just do MLB the Show. And honestly, the reviews on it are consistently like high mid 80s, like solid reviews. People like them. Like user reviews are pretty high. It doesn't seem like they recycle a ton of content. This year's game apparently adds like an editor, your like home field diamond, whatever it's called, home base.
I don't think it's base, GD.
You take me out to your the home ball base, take me out to the show.
This got real porny, I think.
The ball base. What the no one says that.
Dude,
no one said that.
Hey, baby.
No.
You want to visit the ball base?
Visit the ball base.
That's the worst.
That's what I call my underpants.
Your underpants.
All of this.
I'm so sorry.
You can edit your ballpark in MLB the Show to make the walls higher. Is ballpark? Is that doing it for you too, Peterson?
You can't. I'm so sorry. You can't say the word ball anymore for the rest
apparently
of the episode.
I'm 12, so don't say balls, please.
You don't even have to say balls. Just ball. Any ball, I'm out. I can't. I'm going to lose it.
Sports are beyond me. So MLB the Show. 21. The last couple games, I think like the last five or so games have been on, they've been exclusive
PlayStation.
PlayStation.
Nowhere
else. Which is kind of interesting to have a sports game that was like a console exclusive, because I think that's pretty unique, because usually with sports games, they're trying to get them out in front of as many people as possible, right?
Yeah. Yeah. You have to, because your audience is already small. For like want to play sports.
In fact, these guys, I just looked, have only ever developed games for the PlayStation. The very first game, The Mark of Kree, for the PlayStation 2 in 2005. Ever since then, every single thing has been either PSP, PS2, PS3, PS4, PS Vita. And then MLB the Show 21 will be on Xbox.
Day one on Game Pass.
Oh,
day one better release Game Pass. So you can buy it if you've got your PlayStation ready to play MLB the Show. You can pay $70 for it.
Mm-hmm.
Or
seems a good price. Good game.
Xbox Game Pass
for free.
I mean, the Game Pass price, which is essentially free. Dude, so PlayStation, MLB the Show fans who have their PlayStation ready to go, they are pissed.
Tell me they're mad that someone's getting something for free that they're not.
How dare you?
Can't we just be happy? No.
Happy?
No.
What am I supposed to do now? Am I supposed to get Game Pass now? PlayStation for life.
Dude, I hate this attitude. I really do. Like, you see someone else getting something for free. Like, I'm not getting mad that, like, PlayStation Plus owners get to play, like, whatever dumb Who's It game for free. I don't know why this is, like, a theme in the gaming industry. But the thing is that I really feel on this one is just silly. if say you bought a PlayStation 5 and you went through all the rigmarole to get one because you wanted to play Spider-Man because it was console exclusive to the PlayStation 5. That was the whole thing. And you're like, okay, well, I'm going to do this. I'm going to go through
like
all this
your
hassle.
Living room is decorated like Spider-Man. Like you're a Spider-Man fanatic.
Yeah. And so you get this then it comes out on Xbox and it's free. You know what? I'd be like, okay, you can
be
a little ticked. Yeah. You can be a little ticked because I don't know if they were, but I mean, honestly, they're the same price. They're both good consoles. And arguably the PlayStation 4 is cooler because it's got the dope controller. This is not Spider-Man.
No, this is
MLB
the Show.
MLB the Show. If you guys bought PlayStation 5, if you guys spent $500 and fought lines and scalpers.
Yeah, you've already
and all this
bought
other
it for $800.
For MLB the Show 21, I don't know.
That's, you're doing something wrong. I think,
you apparently are super invested, so you don't get to complain.
I feel like you're not video gaming right at that point. Because everything is fluid. Like, you should know this. You should know better that everything's going to come out. Look, Microsoft is going to own all of it. I'm telling you, they're going to be on PlayStation. They'll be on Xbox Game Pass will be on PlayStation. It'll be there last, but it will be there. This is just another step in that direction. They're going to start getting other PlayStation exclusives on Game Pass, and it's just going to drive PlayStation to have Game Pass on their system. I'm telling you.
Until then, boys, stay mad.
Oh, be so salty. If you're not salty about this, then you're not even a show, MLB the Show fan, for real.
Again, we're going back to it. We're all entitled, and if someone else is getting something for free... By God, I better be getting something for free.
Oh, you better. I'm not paying $70 for this now. I want it for $10 a month.
I'm going to hit my PlayStation with a sledgehammer.
Please. Oh, my gosh. If I saw a video of someone smashing their brand new PlayStation because of MLB The Show.
Dude, I've been trying to find one. I casually was like the other day in... I must be the most naive dumbass on the planet. I have this video game podcast where we're constantly talking about the shortages of these consoles. But somewhere in my big dumb head, I was like, I kind of want a PlayStation 5. I think I could have one now.
Oh,
I just hopped on Google. Like, I'll just look for
like all those other idiots didn't think to Google where can I buy where to buy PS5. Those idiots didn't even look.
I was like, it's been out forever. I mean, haven't you guys figured this out by now? Like, I waited so patiently. I waited all the way until April, and what the hell? What's going on? What are you guys doing? So, no, guys, it is still impossible to find a PlayStation 5. You're shit out of luck.
I know a guy on Facebook. He's probably sitting on 30 of them. He's a huge douchebag, and he's going to make you go pick it up yourself, but he'll sell it to you for $1,200. No problem.
Unbelievable. Okay, well, if you have it, you can play MLB The Show. So For 70 bucks. And you'll like it. You don't get to complain. Because here's the other thing. It's not like you can just go out and buy... I guess they are mad, because it's not like they can just go out and buy an Xbox now. That's like, there's no answer to that. There's not like, oh, well, just go get an Xbox One. Just trade them. Nope.
Just trade.
Can't do that.
You could probably find someone who'd be willing to trade.
A straight-up trade? Now, that would be fascinating.
Just for MLB The Show. Dude, this is a lot of work just for this game.
Yeah, wait. So the trade is set up in the Walmart parking lot, and the kid walking over with the PlayStation is like, oh man, I'm so excited to play ML. The guy with the Xbox, like, oh, I can't wait to get that PlayStation. I can play Spider-Man. I can play some like, really cool exclusives. And he hands it over to the other guy. He's like, hey, what are you going to play on this? What are you going to play on this Xbox? What are you so eager to trade for this Xbox? He's like, oh man, I got my sights set on MLB The Show 21.
He has an MLB The Show t-shirt on. He's like, MLB The Show 18, right? It's like few years
this
old.
This was the best year, man. Oh, man. And if you look on the back, I got all the dev signatures that year. Oh, it was
He's
so
got
cool.
dev signing his t-shirt. Yeah. Dude, I went to E3. They
Brody
signed
gave me
it.
A high five.
Oh, my gosh.
Coolest shit ever. All right. This is a good segue because you mentioned E3. Guys, this year, E3, digital E3, that is, will be free for everyone. Really missed opportunity to call it E-free, but then again, Netflix released a documentary called C-spiracy, so apparently no one knows what the fuck a pun is. Fuck you, Netflix!
You can't
C-spiracy?
Just... Well, yeah.
C!
That doesn't Spiracy? Even sound the same. What are we doing?
Are you stupid? Conspiracy?
Yeah, they're idiots.
Conspiracy. So you whiffed on that one.
C-spiracy?
C-spiracy?
It's like, oh, guys, I got this.
I want to pull your teeth out with pliers. I can't believe you would do this to my ears.
No, the guy who, like, I don't know, at the very end point, he had to, like, type in, this is the name of our thing, and he just put the C in the wrong spot. He was like, well, they put C in there somewhere.
Fuck
I was like,
up.
I don't know, C-conspiracy, right. C-spiracy, whatever, sends it in. And
it's like your mom, it's like Nintendo or a Nintendo or something. Yeah, something
like that. And then it rolls out on Netflix and the producer's like, wait, C-spiracy?
C-spiracy seems yeah, like I'm they so made sorry. A movie called Conspiracy, and then The Asylum made a follow-up documentary called C-spiracy. And we sat here and we're like, nice. Good job, nice. Asylum. That's fucking hilarious. No one would ever, in their right mind, title a documentary that. I'm so mad at Netflix. I almost canceled my membership when I saw that shit pop up. How dare you? So, E-free.
He wrote a hateful email. You
it's not
going to
be
this.
It's not going to be called Digital Free 3 or E-free. E-free. Sorry, none of that because no one wants me to be happy. But it's cool. I guess that's tight. It's going to feel like G4 TV did back in the day, I assume, where you can just kind of drop in to whatever showcases you're into. And quite frankly, this seems like the only way that E3 has a chance of survival.
Yeah,
when publishers and studios really just don't need this anymore. Everything's online. All that matters is the trailer. And quite frankly, that doesn't matter all that much either. It's just like you don't need E3 for hype, and you haven't needed E3 for hype for years.
Ooh, so it looks like they might have demos too, which has been the biggest issue with the online stuff. You're like, what, dude? The whole thing is like go with BlizzCon. Mm-hmm. It's like you can play demos if you go. So then I go to BlizzCon line and can't do any of that. So this looks like they've added the ability for people to demo the games. I don't know how that's going to work, but we'll see if people take the publishers take advantage of it.
Yeah, that would be slick. So tight. Looking forward to E3. I hope E3 recognizes that. I hope they shift more into like the mid-size to indie games, because that's what an E3 could really do, is bolster games that don't have an audience or don't have a platform outside of, you know, where they're trying on social media or X, Y, or Z.
We've talked about it a million times. They don't, the big companies, big games, they don't need it. Honestly, they don't.
So if you transition E3 into more of a festival type
I would love it.
Feel where you can get a lot of games out there and you can go there to see a ton of games that you might not be able to access versus Gears of War 17. Like, that's not doing anything for me anymore. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm cool with seeing your guys' trailer online for Gears 17 and I'll go play the demo. I don't really need you guys to build a gigantic booth with life-size figurines. I think that's kind of passed. All right. So let's move on to some kudos.
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 All right. Kudos is our positivity segment. We have to give a shout out to something awesome, and I just can't wait. In fact, I can't believe I got all the way through this episode without mentioning it. But guys, Godzilla vs. Kong is out now on HBO Max and in theaters. I think it's had a record breaking year for record breaking for all whatever 2021. It's just It's so good, you guys. It's so good. This is the follow-up to Godzilla King of Monsters and Kong Skull Island. And earlier, I think it was just called Godzilla. So it's the fourth one in this like connected monsterverse.
It's all connected? I didn't know
that. Yeah, were you not aware of that?
Mm-mm.
Yeah, so this is the Kong from Skull Island, the one with Samuel Jackson that was set in the 70s. So Kong's been 50 more years. He's like bigger. The idea was, so he's the biggest Kong they've ever had. And he's about as big as Godzilla. And I mean, this is all in the trailers, so it's not a spoiler, but guys, he fights Godzilla with an axe made out of a Godzilla spine.
Ooh, I like that.
Are you kidding me? He's using the monkey has an axe, and then he fights him on a battleship, and then he fights. Oh, guys,
JD loves this.
It's so good. And beyond my just like complete rose colored glasses with kaiju movies, I will admit Godzilla King of Monsters was a weak film. There were some dope battles, but the plot and the pacing and the structure of the film itself, even like the color palette was like off-putting. It was like, oh man, especially the last like 30 minutes were just yellow. It was like, ah, what the fuck's going on? This movie is not that. Honestly, it feels like just a kaleidoscope of colors, which is so cool. They visit the Hollow Earth. So big shout out to fellow Hollow Earth believers out there. Of course it's hollow.
Of course
what
it's
else
hollow.
Would it be
wait,
full of
wait,
lead?
Wait, wait. Are there people who still don't think the Earth is hollow?
No. Wow. No, you said it wrong. People who still don't know the Earth is hollow. Mm,
my gosh.
Which is
what
dude,
year are we in?
Dude, the hollow
obviously
Earth,
it's hollow.
It's obviously hollow. It's science, dummies. Ugh. I think it does a better job of actually trying. And so I like world building stuff. I like it's okay in my mind that Godzilla just shows up and fucks shit up and they're like, oh, there's a monster. What do we do? And then he leaves and that's just how it goes. This movie actually tries to explain where he came from. In the same way that the Pacific Rim did. Pacific Rim's like, here, there's a portal where they're coming from, and they're being controlled by aliens. This movie's like, here, this is their... He's from the Hollow Earth, and that's, like, where the big monsters come from. And you're like, all right. All right. I can dig on that. So if you can accept that, you can accept the whole rest of the film. It's awesome. Godzilla shoots a laser beam through the Earth to the Hollow Earth to let Kong know it's ready to fight.
Oh, wow.
It's the coolest shit you've ever seen. And then Kong's like, cool, I'm coming.
All right, I guess we're doing this.
I've
got to
jump
it's
through Hollow
time.
Earth first. Thanks for making me an elevator. It's the coolest shit ever. Guys, if you haven't seen it, it's on HBO. If you don't have HBO, honestly, kind of worth it for $14. You get a whole month of HBO. And then you could watch Godzilla versus Kong. And I am fairly certain this was a litmus test. Their contract ended in 2020. Obviously this got delayed and pushed out because of the pandemic, and so they extended it. But this movie was supposedly kind of a litmus test for Toho, yeah, which is the is that Toho?
I don't know what you're saying. Do I need to call the ambulance again?
Yes, actually. Toho is the Japanese company that owns the Godzilla license. And so they allowed Legendary Films, they have a contract with Legendary to make these four movies through 2020. And this was kind of like, if this had been as, I think, as kind of rough as King of Monsters was, this would have been it. And we might not get a Monsterverse kaiju mix up like ever again. But because this is, because it was good, and because I think it did establish like some really cool storylines that they might continue, people were talking about combining this with Pacific Rim.
Just bring it all together.
Just mash them all together. All Who cares? Like, whatever. So, guys, kudos. My highest praises. King of Monsters was meh. Godzilla vs. Kong is by far my favorite kaiju movie ever.
Oh, nice.
It's so good.
All right, I have a kudos as well. JD, real quick, before I go into it, I want you to pull up IMDb and search up this show, Invincible, and pull up the cast, because it is wild. all the people in this. But I started watching Amazon Prime. And you got to go down. Go all the way. Look at the whole cast. It's crazy. But on Prime, there's a show called Invincible. And I hadn't heard anything about it. It was like an 18 plus rating, and it's animated, and it's a superhero show. So I was like, I'll check it out. Why not? And I am hooked. Oh my gosh. I just started episode 3, and I love it so much. It is, here's the premise of it. It's like every superhero show you've ever watched mashed into one. It's like, Spider-Man and Sky High and Superman and Justice League. It's like all of them together. So there's a kid, regular kid. His dad is essentially Superman. And they like shamelessly rip off superheroes. They don't care. It's based off of a comic book series that does this like on purpose.
Right.
So Superman guy's name is Omni-Man. He's from a different planet. He has a son. And the son doesn't have powers. And he's like, ugh, I want powers. And he's like, I'm lame. And then, of course, he develops powers. He gets his powers. So his dad, who's the Superman guy, is training him to be a superhero. Then I don't want to spoil anything, but all this crazy stuff happens. It is very bloody, very gory, especially for an animated show. It's like, oh, my gosh, the stuff that's happened. Heads getting like squoze to death.
I just watched splattered. That scene. It was very deeply upsetting for me.
Yeah, dude. Did you see the whole scene of it?
Yeah.
It's like, oh my gosh, dude. And it just comes at you all at once. Yeah. And so, but it is, gosh, I am obsessed with this show. The cast in it, the voice cast, every time I pause it, you know, when you pause a show in Prime, it'll pull up like who's the actors in the scene.
Mm-hmm.
Every time I'm like, what? He's in this? She's
That's
in this?
That's such a cool feature, by the way. I love that.
It's so cool. It's wild. You'll have to go look at it. It has, like, all of the people. There's some really big names in there, but there's a million people that you're like, oh, wait, I think I know who that is. And then you, like, look at their picture, and you're like, oh, yeah, I know exactly who that dude is. Oh, I know exactly who she is, right? It is, oh, gosh, I am in love with this show. Of course, I know people have that superhero fatigue. This is not tapping into that for me at all. I'm just really, really enjoying it. I want to watch it all the time.
All of the episodes this graphic, or is this just they just do it for fun?
So the first episode ends very graphic, and it's like not at all up until there, right? There's this one like decently long scene that's like, oh my gosh. And then it has stuff in there that is graphic, but I haven't seen anything else that bad yet. So it's not like constantly just like heads exploding and stuff like that. I'm sure we'll see more of that, but episode 2 was not that graphic at all.
Okay. Well,
so, that's... that didn't bother me at all. It was shocking for a second. But again, I got to give the disclaimer of don't watch this with
yes, don't watch. Your it's kids a cartoon. Around. I'll watch it with my kids. God,
oh,
no.
My gosh, please don't. I even told my son, I was like, yeah, you can't watch this. And he's like, why not? It's a cartoon. And I was like, it's really bloody. And he's like, I can handle bloody. And I was like, I know you think you've seen bloody before, but you haven't seen this, right?
No,
this
you haven't gross. Seen whatever this is god awful shit is. This
but
is like
I,
full metal or whatever.
Yeah. So it's called Invincible. I am fully obsessed with it right now. I love it so much. So check it out if you have Prime and you don't mind some heads exploding.
Lots of heads exploding. Okay, so we're going to do some JD Asks.
JD asks.
I don't know, guys. We're going with JD asks. JD's ass. All right, JD asks is where I ask something that I want to know. I just got to know. And this week,
Gots to know.
There was a really cool April Fool. I shared this in our Discord channel. There was a really cool April Fool's joke from Remedy Entertainment, the guys that made Control. That really awesome,
X-Files
type video game. Yeah. It was the secret government organization for keeping mysteries, and you were this superhero director of this organization. Oh, it was just so tight. And they released a trailer, quote unquote, April Fool's trailer for the PlayStation 1 port of this game. And so if you're familiar with PlayStation 1 graphics and like how it looks, imagine like that with that skin on the Control like gameplay. The standard gameplay where as kind of this superhero-ish character, you're dashing around and jumping and flying and grabbing characters and throwing them and stuff. It was the coolest looking thing. And the idea that
it really did look like, I don't like the nostalgic cool. It was like, oh man, this looks sick.
Yeah. And so it got me to thinking, and I think someone coined the term D-make. So this isn't a game remake. This is a game you take that's from a current generation or an older generation, and you make it much older. I don't know if there's any extant examples of this. I don't know if anyone's ever actually done this beyond
like I don't think trailers a studio's actually
and screenshots
done it.
And cool stuff.
Yeah,
but man, the first guys that do it will be neat. So I wanted to ask for this. JD asks, which modern game do you want to see D-makes of?
Why don't you start us off with one?
Sure, I've got a couple. First one, which would be kind of interesting, I think, would be Fortnite.
Dude, I put Fortnite on my list, but I put Fortnite Save the World.
Yep, because like, obviously no older console is going to be able to handle 100 people, or older anything's going to be able to handle 100 people on it. But the Save the World mode, which you could have as a four-player co-op mode in like a PlayStation 2, Fortnite Save the World on PlayStation 2 would have been the definitive PlayStation 2 cool game. People would have obsessed with that game. The snap building, the building table being applied to a third person shooter. Actually, it was a first person shooter for a minute there. Yep. Oh man, I think Fortnite could be an awesome D-make.
Pixelated graphics would work.
It would matter. Yeah, it's not like the graphics are the winning part of Fortnite that anyone cares about. No one cares about the graphics. That's why they played on their phone.
Yep. That's funny you had that, because I had that same exact one, and I was like, man, Save the World.
I have another one I think we might both have. Okay, let me see. Do you have Rocket League?
I don't have Rocket League on there.
Rocket League would work. Honestly, you could make Rocket League on the SNES.
Oh, man.
You would even just like strip out the graphics. You could probably do it. There's probably an engine that could have run that on the SNES. If not that, at the very minimum, the N64. I'm just picturing at Mario Kart and the tech required to play Mario Kart. All you have to do is apply that to, I mean, that's quite a bit more graphics. I do understand probably being way reductionist, but I think Rocket League, because I mean, there have been car games ever since there have been video games.
Yep.
How did it take us so long to get to Rocket League? How did it take us so long to get to cars playing soccer in a gigantic 3D field?
Yeah, and I think you'd have to limit some of the things like the flying, because I think it, with worse graphics, it might be harder to judge the distance of the ball, but I don't know. Maybe not.
Yeah.
Maybe it'd be easy, because I remember sometimes struggling with like baseball games and stuff, when to swing the bat. It was more of a like timing thing than noticing where the ball was.
Yeah.
So you might have to dumb down some of those things, but it absolutely would work. I think you're totally right. Throw it on the N64 when we first started seeing really like 3D worlds.
Yeah.
Throw it on that. Oh my gosh. It'd be it works so fine. Cool. It'd be awesome too.
Mind blowing stuff. Yeah, that would have blown minds back on the N64. Oh, that'd be so cool. Okay, what do you have a good one?
Okay, so I put No Man's Sky on here, and here's why. JD and I were talking last night, which is probably why it was on my mind. But No Man's Sky, I think one of the downfalls of it was they tried to make it so big. It's so huge. It's infinite, right? And so at first glance, that sounds really wonderful. That sounds amazing. When I heard everything was procedurally generated, I was thinking you were going to get like random monsters and stuff like that, aliens looking all crazy and funky. And you quickly come to realize there's like a handful of models for aliens and creatures, and you kind of see them all in the plants. It doesn't matter the world you go to. If it's a poisony air type of world, you're going to see these types of things. And
right.
So it gets really samey. It doesn't matter what planet you go to. I want them. So you don't need to make it this unlimited universe. Dumb it down. Give me 10 planets, a little bit different on each of them. Same type of thing. But you can add. One of the things I didn't like about No Man's Sky was the building. It was I felt like it was awkward
and boring.
It was hard to like do. Dumb it down to pixel graphics, and you can build. So make the building more essential. Make the travel to make each planet essentially its own thing. Just take all of those races and take all of those creatures and different biomes and stuff. And just dumb it down to like 10 planets, right? And then you're just going and discovering in this game in a, you know, in like a PS1 type of graphics. You don't need fantastic graphics for this type of thing.
That's just so sick.
Because the whole point was exploring and building a base and getting better and getting more stuff and, you know what I mean, being able to fight better guys. Dude,
and the way you would handle this on the PlayStation 1, because if you remember Final Fantasy VII and a number handful of other games. I think there was one game, maybe it was Final Fantasy VII on the PlayStation 1 that had three discs. So the way you handle this is you have 10 different planets, and every time you want to travel to a different planet, you just put that disc in.
Just do a new disc.
That's how it works.
Dude, that's how, I mean, I remember games with six discs.
Yeah,
when
exactly.
When I was a kid.
You're thinking install discs. But these were like you actually had to change. Well, on you computer, like got to a certain part of the story.
On the computer, yeah, you'd have to switch discs.
Yeah.
That was like a common thing. It was like, well, switch to disc 4. And you're like, okay, plug it.
It's so cool. That's what I want. I want someone to release a 10-disc No Man's Sky D-make for the PlayStation 1.
With like pixelated graphics.
Oh, my.
I want you to dumb it down. And I just want it to, all the good elements, just condense them. And I, yeah, that's what I
want. That'd be the coolest shit. Okay, so here's one that I think would work. I want to go way back. Do an SNES, do NES, whatever. Do a 2D version. This thing seems to write itself. You know Portal? You know the box art we talked about a couple weeks ago, how there's like that stick figure on it that's kind of misleading, and you think it's going to be like a stick figure
just
game?
Do that.
You're literally making the game from the box of Portal. On the SNES or whatever.
Dude, you could do that on the NES.
Sega Genesis. I don't care, but you're making that game. And so you have the portals and the same physics. If you have 2D, but it's like 2D. And so
a
you
2D
have to like
puzzle
make sure,
portal game.
Yeah, exactly. You could apply the exact same portal physics to a 2D space that you have in the 3D game. And I think, and then it could just be this quirky little dingus game. God, Valve could do that in a weekend.
Dude,
I think that would be hilarious.
It'd be so sick. The next Portal game is
Portal 3.
Portal 3
is on
2D.
Yes. Yeah.
Pixelated, boxy, puzzle game.
Carries on the story. Same voice. I mean, GLaDOS with SNES like pixel or bit voice would be awesome.
I don't know how you're picturing it, but I'm picturing it like a platformer almost.
Yeah.
Like I'm looking at my guy and I'm just aiming my gun up or down and then just like boop, shoot up there.
Yep. Yep.
That would be fun. I think it'd be
fun. You just have rooms. I mean, you could do it in a room. I can't believe they don't have a portal type of mechanic in a 2D game. I've never seen it.
I mean, I'm sure someone tried to
steal
knock
it
off, but
I've never seen one. To be honest, I've never seen a two-sided like portal gun in any game since Portal. Everyone just seems like kind of scared of it. They're like,
don't touch the portal gun.
Everyone will know we're just ripping it off, but I mean, it seems too good not to. Yeah. It's a portal gun.
They're not busy making games, so they have all the time in the world to come
they're
sue us.
Sue the shit out of us. quietly over the last 10 years, Valve replaced every one of their employees with attorneys.
They just got.
We never saw it.
They have no devs. They have no devs. They just have lawyers.
They're on LinkedIn, they're called software engineers, but in reality, the reason they're not making games is because they're actually just corporate attorneys.
They're just suing people left and right. That's all they do. Let's see. I had a couple others. Some of them were like games I was disappointed in that I wish they would just kind of roll back and do the better, what was better before. But this one is not one of those. Overwatch on the N64. N64 version of Overwatch. It's a first-person shooter. Same type of thing. You just have it. I don't know. I just think the N64 graphics, or PS1 perhaps graphics, on Overwatch would be quirky and fun.
I think they would be boxy and shitty, but I do. You know what I think you should do? If you're thinking Overwatch, Xbox. What is more perfect for LAN parties?
Dude, yeah, you're right. Throw it on the Xbox, but let's bump it up Overwatch. A couple notches. Throw it on Xbox.
Oh,
you've
so
got
good.
Four people.
8v8s.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, man.
Only LAN, right? There's no
only LAN. Like, but you could have, stuff. You know, Overwatch would still be fun and if you got your friends over to play a four-player on the Xbox. That would still be so fun. Overwatch, because that was Xbox was that was Team Fortress 1, right? Wasn't that on the Xbox? So like that type of, let's see.
I mean, it existed. Yeah, existed at that time. It's interesting that it didn't seem like it was as big as like Halo, like the arena fighter.
Yeah, it wasn't on Xbox, I guess.
It's on computer, so PC. That,
but yeah, like you said, it was out there. So
put it on the Xbox. I think it'd just be fun and like quirky, especially going back and seeing like, oh my gosh, this is May. She looks incredible. And like this, the things just, they don't look nice. They just look old and that kind of nostalgic.
Yeah.
And that'd be kind of fun. It'd be kind of fun to see that. I mean, if you go and look these up, like you don't think it would be that cool until you look it up and you're like, ooh, show me some D-makes, you know, that sort of thing. And every single one of them looks cool. Every single one of them, you're like, yes, I want the BioShock one. That looks so awesome.
The beauty of making a D-make in 2021 is that we have had 20 years to reflect on what was awesome in each individual game. Like, which games were able to suck the most out of these consoles and make the game look at its absolute best. And I think in 10 years, we'll be looking back at how Red Dead Redemption 2 just absolutely, and Red Dead Redemption 1 for the Xbox 360 and the PlayStation 3, like pushed those to their absolute limits. There were games like that on the N64 and the SNES going all the way back. I mean, look at Super Metroid. Look at the stuff they're able to portray just in the background art of that game. And to be able to make a game like that now with 20 years of hindsight, they could be so cool. So, the last one I put on here, but I'm realizing is kind of dumb, was Minecraft. But if you made a 2D Minecraft, isn't it just Terraria?
Yeah. It's
you D-make Minecraft, it just turns into Terraria eventually.
Yeah. There's a bunch of those ripoffs of that sort of thing.
Yeah.
I had one more. And this is just a wish list at this point, but Cyberpunk. But I want Cyberpunk in the vein of like the old Sierra games, like King's Quest and Space Quest. I want them on the PC. I want them at like a point and click look.
Okay.
Kind of like what gets me there is that game I've had on my Steam wish list for 100 years, The Last Night. It's pixely, but it's beautiful. And I think you could do that with a cyberpunk type of world. And I think it would just be, I don't know. I think it would be charming to see that type of game, to see a cyberpunk type of world in a like a Space Quest or King's Quest type of graphics and play style.
Dude, that's sick. I dig that. I can get behind that. Cool. Well, if we don't have any more, let's do a first impression rose.
Oh my God, the first impression rose.
All right, so I teased this a little bit before, and I think we all knew this was coming, but I'd like to give out my first impression rose to a very special game. It's not a looker.
Mm-hmm.
But wow, is it an amazing game, Loop Hero. So Loop Hero, if you are unfamiliar, is, oh gosh, I kept thinking, how am I going to describe this game? Loop Hero, the graphics are terrible. In fact, whenever there's like older looking graphics games, I'm usually like, I'm fine with this. I don't mind if they don't look better. This is a game that I actually wish it looked a little better.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because the graphics are not exciting in the least bit. I mean, the cutscene graphics are cool and they're fun, yeah, with like the characters, but the actual gameplay is not. And like, for example, you're all constantly, well, here, I'll go back. So Loop Hero starts, you are a character that is thrown into like an endless time loop. And they really take the loop theme and run with it, because when a game starts, you are given a path in a loop, you know, just a winding path that just loops on itself. Mm-hmm. And your character just walks around the path. You don't control the character. The only thing you control is if they stop or go. You don't choose direction or anything. It just goes around the path. And on that path it'll first start off blank path, nothing on it, nothing on the outside of it. Just a blank path, and your character will walk and like slimes will appear and you'll fight them, and then you'll kill them and they'll drop gear, and you're just picking up gear, gearing yourself up. And so one of my graphical nits is when you're fighting, it pulls up this little animation of your like characters fighting. You don't control the fighting either. You just run into them. You can literally just not do anything and the game will play.
Mm-hmm.
And when the when the fighting animation pops up, I wish my guy was like wearing the gear that I put on him, or have the swords that I put on him, but they just have the same animation no matter what. But you go through, you get this gear, and you're trying to optimize your gear. And as you go through this loop, it gets a little bit harder every time you go make a full rotation of the loop. But every time you kill an enemy, you're getting these cards that you can play, and they are like tiles, essentially, that you play on the board. And it adds things like stat bonuses, or it adds events when your guy crosses that. So there's like a graveyard that you can put a place on the board where a chest will appear in there. Every time you go around, you'll have a chest that you can open up with gear in it. But also, if an enemy is on the graveyard tile, there's a chance that it will become a ghost when you kill it. And then you got to kill the ghost of that enemy too. So just all sorts of stuff like that. You're just placing tiles that kind of do something to the board. Most of them add enemies, to be honest, because once you have added enough buildings to it, and the whole thing is your character can't remember anything.
Mm-hmm.
It just like your character ended up in this world and you're like, I don't know what's happening. No one knows what's happening.
Just going to walk in circles.
You're just walking around killing stuff. And then as you're placing tiles, that's like your character remembering the terrain. Oh yeah, there was a field here. Oh yeah, there was a vampire castle here or whatever. So you're placing all that stuff down, and you get like these persistent resources as well. So you get loot, but you also get like stone and things you can build with, because once you die, you go back to this like main base, a camp where some other people have found you, and you start building the camp up as you go with these resources. So there's a little bit of that roguelike, because every round is different, but also you're collecting resources through each round to kind of build up your camp, which gives you new cards to play, which gives you maybe stat bonuses in the world or different things you can do as you go through the loop. And then once you've built enough stuff, an end boss will appear on the loop and you fight the end boss, which is pretty hard, especially your first time. You're like, I'm never going to be able to beat this guy ever. He's too good. Mm-hmm. And eventually you do beat him. You kind of figure it out and you beat him. And then it's like the option. It's a roguelike. It's like, well, now you can go around a harder loop. It's going to be just a little bit harder. And I don't know why it's so fun, because again, you're not doing really anything besides gearing your guy. He goes through a fight, he gets gear and cards. You're placing the cards on the board and gearing up your character, and that's it. Really, you just, and then it's just you push space bar to go and stop. And so I don't know what it is, but mm-hmm. once you start playing this, it's so addicting. It's so, I mean, the first time I booted it up, I was like, okay, I'm gonna play some Loop Hero. And I played for 4 hours. It's just one of those awesome games that just kind of sucks you in, because you're like, ah, I can do better. That sucked. Like, just getting bad pulls for loot, whatever. Oh, I'm going to try to up my whatever stat this time and see if that helps. Yeah, this game is really fun, and it is dirt cheap. I can't even remember how much I picked it up for, but it was like nothing. It was like $15. Yes, $15.
Oh, sick.
Put it on your wish list. It'll definitely go on sale. But this one kind of took the gaming world by storm for a minute. You know, everyone was talking about Loop Hero, and it's calmed down a little bit. It's not like Untitled Goose Game.
right.
But this is a great little game, and it's one that you can come back to and you haven't missed a beat, right? It's not like, I got to remember how to do these attacks, and you don't have to remember anything. You just, stop and go. So that's Loop Hero. Again, it does get my first impression rose because it is weirdly fun. I've only played 10 hours. I know some of our listeners have put in 50 hours for Skylar. So,
wow.
We've got some listeners who have really put in a ton of hours. It's a fun game. It honestly is a fun game. Absolutely 100% worth $15. I would tell anyone to go buy this and give it a shot, because it is. And look, you can always return it if you don't like it, because you will know what the game is within 2 hours. I can promise you that.
That's tight.
That's Loop Hero.
It's not a big investment. Okay, that just means we got Dice of Destiny. Let's do it.
Dice of Destiny.
All right, Dice of Destiny is this awesome little game we play at the end of every episode. We roll a 6-sided dice to see who will be rolling the Dice of Destiny itself, which is a 20-sided dice with 20 different game genres assigned to it. Once that person has rolled the Dice of Destiny and gotten their genre, they then roll a 6-sided dice to see how much money they can spend on that game. And then later they report back the game that they chose, and they will play that game and review it. At a later date, Peterson rolled a space game for like $60 a couple weeks ago. Went to
Hardspace Shipbreaker is the game that I picked, and it was a recommendation from Joe Mero, who's one of our long-time listeners.
He's mentioned this a couple times, because when I saw it, I was like, this is familiar. I'm pretty sure Joe Mayer has shown it to us.
Yeah, no, he's... excuse me. He's mentioned it several times to me since I think he played it early when it came out. It came out in 2020. He's mm-hmm. mentioned it a couple times. I rolled space, and I was like, dude, I got to do it. I got to play Hardspace Shipbreaker.
Right.
And it's $25... maybe that's a little bit more than I usually spend on like a I'll check it out type of game, but I had an inkling that I would like it. So this is a simulation game. It's a physics-based game, and the premise is actually pretty funny. It's like sad and hilarious at the same time. You are a guy that wants to take a job as a shipbreaker. And what they do is they go, they wear a spacesuit, and they go, and they've got like a laser gun, like a cutting gun. And you just, there's these ships in a docking bay that you need to disassemble and do something with the materials. So there's, you know, different places. There's like a furnace where you'll put like garbage metals and stuff. And then there's like a refinery type of thing. So you just send them into the different spots.
Which, by the way, shipbreaking is one of the most fascinating, cool things ever. Like real life shipbreaking.
Is it a real thing? They really do it?
Shipbreaking?
Yeah.
Yeah, there's like shipbreaking yards. If you Google it, there's like a ton in Asia. You just drag a ship, like an old decommissioned ship, up on shore. And then you just cut it into scrap metal.
Yeah,
it's obviously incredibly dangerous work. But you can see these ships that are just being taken apart piece by piece by essentially what you're describing, lasers, or they're cutting through it, obviously.
Yep.
With cutting tools. But shipbreaking, just the pictures of these massive structures and then dudes that are just crawling over it like ants. Taking them down is so neat. So that's, I mean, that's a cool subject.
That's what this game is. That's what this game is.
So cool.
You're just a dude. But so the premise, though, is hilarious. You have to get this job, you need to take out a loan for the equipment, right? And the loan is 1 billion credits.
That seems reasonable. I'm sure the interest rate is great.
And, oh, no. And so you work for this company now. It's called Lynx Corp, and you owe them 1 billion credits, and that is like apparent. It is on the menu screen everywhere. Down. Like you see it all the time. How much money you owe, and you start breaking ships, and realize you're never going to pay off 1 billion credits. Because as you do this, like you have to buy your own equipment. Like you need oxygen to break ships, right? Because you're out in space. Floating around, and your oxygen runs out. You have to go back and restock oxygen, which is like 5,000 credits.
Oh my God, it costs money to breathe. Man, dude, this is the dream. This is the dream.
Aggressive capitalism, and it's honestly, it's very tongue-in-cheek with that. If you want to, hey, like they will constantly be saying, oh, your oxygen level is getting very low.
$5.99.
Our data has shown. Oh, you have to go back and get it too, which is a huge pain in the butt. But they're like, but the computer will say to you, our data has shown that it is not beneficial for the company for you to run out of oxygen. It costs. they don't care about you. They care about how much it costs them.
Right.
Yes. It's so funny and sad. But you're doing. But the whole thing. Is you are this worker and you have a shift and your shift is 15 minutes of real time, 15 minutes where you've got this ship and you go and disassemble it and you're trying to do it as best as you can. It takes time. The controls, oh man, they're still a little funky because you're in space. So you can rotate, you can move side to side, you can go up and down, you can go any direction, right? And luckily there is a way to like just break and just stop moving. Which you use constantly. Because, yeah, I mean, it's like the anti-gravity thing. If you push, go forward, your guy's just going to, like, coast forward forever.
Nothing's ever going to stop him.
Yeah, yeah.
Damn so, Newton.
And the pieces will do that. Like, the ship pieces will kind of, like, start moving away. And you're like, stop it! Get back here. And so, no, it's very... I thought I would like this game. Because it's kind of relaxing. Even though you're on this like time crunch, but if you don't finish the ship, you just work on the same ship your next shift. It doesn't matter. You just keep
going.
It's not
going anywhere.
Yeah, it's not going anywhere. You can switch ships if you want, but they'll charge you. They'll charge you for not fully breaking down this ship, which is pretty funny. Again, if you break stuff on the ship, like if you accidentally mess a valuable part up, they charge you for it. You got to pay for it. So you're just constantly. Every time you go back there, you have to pay fees. Like you have a fee just for going out there. And so sometimes
this is a little too on the nose. Dude,
it's really funny. It honestly, it just makes me laugh every time because you don't think I'm confident I'll never pay off a billion credits, right? And so it's just really funny because it doesn't mean anything. Your debt doesn't. It's just there.
It's never going away, right?
Yeah. I'd be interested to see if anyone can make it go away. But no, this game is relaxing. You just go out in space and you're breaking apart a ship. You're sending the pieces for the salvage. It's satisfying in a weird way. Especially you do the same type of ship over and over and you're like, okay, I know how to do this now. I'm going to send this panel flying over into this thing. It's this game, Jamera was right. Absolutely worth it. It is a wonderful break from anything I've ever played before. I want to play it more. I didn't want to stop playing it when I was playing it. What I will say is, it's not a game I'm going to put 100 hours into. It's not a game I'll put 50 hours into, probably. But so for $25, I feel like, you know, that's like right at the high end of what I mm-hmm. would pay for this and right. be okay paying. Like, I'm fine with what paying $25 for it. But what I would say is this is definitely a niche type of game. So if you're interested, put it on your wish list. It will go on sale. It goes on sale pretty regularly. Not huge. It doesn't go on huge sales, but it'll be less than $25. Put it on your wish list. Pick it up. You won't be disappointed. You will, if you're anything like me, if you're like anal about that type of stuff at all,
yeah,
you're just going to be like, well, I'm just going to break this ship apart and just keep going. And like, there's some fun things like if you break certain, it's like pressurized, the ship is, if you break uh-huh. it apart wrong, it's going to like explode Ooh. And hurt you. And
so you have to be pretty strategic. That's dope.
You do I have to be strategic about it, but it does hold your hand. Like, you push T and it gives you like this, it gives you like a visual image of the ship of everywhere you should cut, things that are pressurized, things that are structural.
This is a first person game, correct?
First person, yeah. Yeah. So
that's slick.
My only nit is the controls get frustrating sometimes, especially when you're on a time crunch and you're like, no, quit I'm flying everywhere. I can't stop. And then you're
do you
just
know
like,
if it has controller
stop.
Support?
Click stop. I don't know. Actually, I bet it does, and I bet it'd be great on a
I was
controller.
Just going to say, I feel like this sounds like it would be better with joysticks to control
Maybe.
A first person. But that's just me, you know.
It might. But anyways, I really enjoy it. Definitely check it out. Put it on your wish list. Wait for a sale.
Sick.
I'm going to play some more for sure.
Hardspace Shipbreaker.
Yes.
Okay, that means we've got a reroll. And because I'm sick and damn tired of not having a game to play other than Valheim. Let's be honest. I'm not tired of Valheim. Never
nope.
gonna be tired of Valheim.
Dude, I want to play Valheim. You said Valheim. Now I want to play it.
Yeah, the game just like crawled under my skin and just lives there now. But
we have so much fun with it. I haven't
gotten this dice for the longest time. So here's how we're going to do it. We're going to do 1 through 5 on the 6-sided dice as JD. If we roll a 6... I will probably not be graceful. So let's see.
Dude, I'll die if we roll 6.
It's
It'll
a
be hilarious.
4.
Okay.
It's a 4. So JD's finally playing a game. And our 20-sided dice pulls up a 14, which is a co-op.
I'm not playing with you.
Wait, does Valheim count?
Oh my gosh. Well, I'm just going to put another 100 hours into Valheim this week, I guess.
The coolest thing ever is that now co-op is off the deck of active games, but backlog is on. Peterson.
Oh, that's a good one.
Backlog.
That's my
the best
favorite
one to get.
Mm-hmm.
That is the number one most primo Dice of Destiny
that's the one I want.
Item because you've already done it. You've already picked your game. Okay, so I will be... Oh, I closed it before I got...
Your price? I've got a 6-sided dice right here.
Roll that.
6-sided dice. I roll a 6.
Okay, so I can spend up to...
Any co-op game you want, except for MLB the Show, which is 70. So you can't...
Shit!
Hit that.
No, I can. I can just play it on Game Pass.
There you go. Get on Game Pass.
I can't play it on PlayStation anyway because they don't exist, pretty much. co-op game. Okay, cool. That's it. I'll pick that out next week and then play it desperately in the last couple hours before the show in 2 weeks because Lord knows I'm not going to stop playing Valheim. All right, guys, that does it for us this week. To play us out, we have a song from Hardspace Songbreaker. Hard rock ship rocking.
That sounds right.
Yeah, that's pretty spot on. I haven't pimped it in a minute, but guys, we do have a Discord. It's awesome.
It's so active. Good.
We have a food channel that people are posting their cooking, their junk food, just literally everything. It's so awesome.
If you can eat it, we'll talk about it
later. We'll talk about it. It's just a really cool, inclusive, awesome Discord channel. So if you guys want to come drop by and say hi, we'd love to have you. You can find a link to it on our Twitter or our Facebook. You can search for us there at 3Bit Gamer Show. I'm JD, logging off.
This is Peterson going AFK.
Peterson Productions.
Oh, yeah.